let's discuss about the lathe. You know, the lathe is a common machine tool. There are so many different types of machine tools. I think you all know about these things. So we mainly focus here about the lathe, about something related to its function and its important parts. Okay, the concept of the lathe, you know, it was derived from some sort of woodworking activities, and this is actually a central lathe. And there are so many different types of lathe, like central lathe, inch lathe, tool room lathe, bench work lathe, capstone and turret lathe, automatic and semi-automatic lathe. And you know, in most of the industry, we derive there was early time, you know, a power was derived from some sort of activities, like, you know, exciting power from steam engines. So that kind of energy used for running this type of machine. So at that time, this was called inch lathe, and it is a modified version of inch lathe called central lathe. So, you know, the lathe is a machine tool used for running cylindrical workpieces and convert this type of, this is the simplest piece of the work, and you can easily convert it into complex form just like this. Okay, so the process we perform on this lathe is actually very simple. In the simplest form, it consists of the left side, right side, and the center part. The left side we call a head stroke, right side called tail stroke. Head stroke consists of some sort of gear drives, spindle mechanism, all the activities governed by head stroke. That's why it's called a head stroke. And the tail stroke for the use for supporting a long workpiece, so stiff, to give stiffness, and just like that. This is center portion called the carriage. Carriage used for mounting tool here, and you can adjust the position of the tool with the help of carriage, and motion of tool along longitudinal and transverse directions controlled by operating these wheels on carriage. Carriage consists of three parts. One is called apron. I mean the lower portion called apron, center portion called saddle, top portion called common rest, and upon that tool post is placed. So let's discuss about the basic fundamental ideas of a central lathe. So I think it is,
we can start with mounting the workpiece on that.
I think we can start from head stroke. So, you know, I always say that in earlier time, power derived from steam engines. But in these cases, I mean, in cases of a central lathe, we derive power from an individual motor. So you can adjust the voltage and current to control the speed of rotation. Your objective is that to mount a workpiece, I mean, the cylindrical workpieces on this chuck, and to rotate. During the rotation, you govern motion of a tool, I mean sharp devices, along some particular path, so as to convert this sort of simplest workpieces into complex form. And so this is a head stroke. Head stroke is a closer form, but actually it is a complex one. In simple form, it consists of a spindle and some sort of gear mechanisms are there. We use the gear mechanisms so we can adjust power and speed at this chuck.
Yeah. Sometimes we will use a belt drive also.
Belt drive also.
Yeah.
You can use the individual motor, and mm-hmm. by adjusting voltage and current, it's possible to control the power and speed here.
Speed of the rotation. Okay.
So we use gear mechanism to control the speed.
Control the speed. Okay. Because different workpieces need different speeds. Yeah. For the, you know, the finish will be depends upon the speed of the rotation actually.
Okay. Depend upon the process, I think. For turning, you need a higher speed. For process like
thread cutting,
boring, you need
slow speed, a very slow speed.
So
actually,
you have to adjust the speed depend upon the process you performed on this.
No, okay. How do we check the orientation in the this chuck?
Orientation in this chuck, what do you mean?
Means if we are fitting some rod.
Yeah.
So how do we check the orientation? And no, can we use some mechanism to place that properly in the chuck?
I think chucks.
There are central, like automatic chucks are there. Okay, so it will be self-centering. Once you, you can already automatically adjust the chuck. Okay, you can move on to the next topic.
This is a self-centering chuck.
Okay.
There are so many different types of chucks, like self-centering, independent chuck, magnetic chuck, collet chuck, wheel chuck, etc. I think this is, you know, it's called a self-centering three jaw chuck because its operation is simple. When you turn keys in this float, automatically the three jaws moves radially inward or outward. So as to clamp the workpiece rigidly. That is its function.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And when you can load the workpieces from this side. I think in mass production, you will from. I mean, you have to convert long workpieces into small pieces. So as to aid the manufacturing, you can easily allow entry of workpieces through this thing.
Through this side, actually. That is
actually called a hollow spindle.
Hollow spindle, okay. So you can continuously feed the workpieces.
Yeah,
great.
The type of lathe is not designed for that kind of work, but I think, you know, some sort of semi-automated lathe, can be, it works on that principle.
Okay.
So,
chuck is over, then we'll go to the tool post, I guess.
After work clamp here, you know, sometimes the work pieces, its length may be huge. Length is too large.
Too large,
so
yeah.
In this situation, you have to give additional support.
Okay.
To give the additional support and to add the stiffness, we use this part. This is called tail stroke.
Tail stroke. Okay.
Okay. You can easily move it along longitudinal direction upon the bed.
Okay.
This is called the bed, and bed. I think it forms the base of all the moving parts of the lathe. Bed is made from cast iron. I think. We use cast iron because of the reason that the cast iron provides graphite in form of flake.
Okay.
So there is less need for
lubrication. Okay. So it is generally used to constrain the motion of the
to constrain the motion of the carriage
tool post. Okay.
You manufacture it in form of this form of
V shapes
and flat base.
Okay. So this is actually the working of a center lathe. Yeah, you can do these movements like.
Yes, that's carriage.
This portion is called carriage. End portion is called carriage, and I always say that carriage is meant for
longitudinal
motion to control the motions of cutting tool.
Cutting tool.
In its simplest form, it consists of three portions. Lower portion is called the apron. Middle portion is called the saddle. Top portion is a common wrist. Okay. Apron mechanism, basically it is a rack and pinion mechanism. There is some sort of pinion though. When you rotate this wheel, what happens really is that wheel is rotated. That pinion is rotating on this track. So automatically this rotary motion will convert into linear motion.
Great.
That's the basic principle. And to give automatic motions, there are some sort of mechanisms are provided. To control the motion of carriage, there is a feed rod, and this is called a feed rod. And this is called lead screw. Lead screw mainly used for
thread cutting operation.
And feed rod for providing automatic feed
to the applications.
And upon this saddle, this apron, there is a cross leg for feeding workpieces in perpendicular direction of lathe axis.
Okay.
Just like this. This provide longitudinal moment to cutter.
Okay.
And this is called the common rest.
Common rest.
You can slide it upon the base. This is a civil base.
To create like tapers, you can create by sliding it or changing the tapers.
Okay. And upon that, there is a two post. It's a four-way two post.
Mm-hmm.
The basic difference from, you know, you already seen a single way. I think you seen mm-hmm. single way
two post also.
In this situation, you can mount different tools
mm-hmm.
so as to perform a longitudinal a sequence of operations.
Can you explain some of the operations done by this lathe? Like
facing.
As in the thing, you can see that there is a thread cutting is there. And taper operation is also done there. And yeah,
it's so
these are some of the operations performed on the
form by using circular form tool.
Yeah, form tool we can
create
use.
This structure.
For different types of tools and operation we will discuss in the next video.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
I think this is the simplest form of a single lathe. It's the simplest of all design. So let us discuss what is the basic parts of a single lathe. I think this is a head stroke. It is a carriage. This end portion is called a carriage. This is called tail stroke. And all these things, you know, it is erected upon a bed.
Good.
Bed which is made up of cast steel.
Hmm.
So let us focus on the functional details of a head stroke. You know, this is a simplest form of a head stroke. You know, it is a design. I think. You know, the head stroke is used for driving power from individual motor and to control the speed and rotation of workpieces which are mounted on this conventional three jochak, I think. So its idle function
mm-hmm.
is that to get different speed depending upon the function. I think for the purposes like turning,
mm-hmm.
you need to have a high speed,
mm-hmm.
low torque.
Okay.
But operation like thread cutting,
mm-hmm.
you need to perform rotation in a manner that slowly. You have to control the movement
mm-hmm.
along a helical path. So
mm-hmm.
so you have to have a
slow speed.
So depending upon the function,
mm-hmm.
I mean, depending upon the operation you perform,
mm-hmm.
you have to control the speed of workpieces.
Okay.
So for that purposes, we use a head stroke.
Head stroke. Okay.
You can see. In its simplest form, it consists of a cone type gear mechanism. There is a individual motor erector this portion. Yeah, this is the individual motor from the belt mechanism. You can easily derive power to this cone.
And you can see that is a V-belt. V-belt is generally used to transmit high power.
Yeah. Actually, I think this is a motor, individual motor. You drive the motor to a common shaft from
through a V-belt drive. We are getting the
we are getting the power from individual motor to a common lathe shaft.
From
the we extract the power to this conical
by using
conical gear
mechanism.
Belt drive actually.
Yeah, you can see this is a step type gear mechanism. You can see. A compound gear drive also.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, this is a step type gear. Depending upon the position of this belt user,
mm-hmm.
you can easily get four different speed. If you put the belt here, you can easily get a high speed. You can shift this belt to different position. Depending upon the position, you can control the. You can get the four different speeds.
So. Great.
When you see the construction,
mm-hmm.
it seems a good, seems a simple one,
mm-hmm.
but actually it's a complex thing.
Okay.
I think all these gears mechanisms are keyed to a hollow shaft called a spindle.
Okay.
You can see it from this portion. This is a hollow spindle.
Hollow spindle. Okay.
And I think the hollow spindle. It is not a throughout structure.
Mm-hmm.
It is a two-piece thing,
okay.
And one piece is this portion is one, and this portion is a second.
Another, okay.
And these gears, I mean, these
These two spindles
mounted between two precise bearings.
Mm-hmm.
Upon this left portion of spindle, you mount.
Mm-hmm.
Belt.
Okay.
We change the position of this belt, and we will get different speeds.
Front speed. Okay.
Okay. So there are two parts basically. Okay. How do we connect these two parts?
I already say that this is the two parts.
Two parts. Yeah.
To actuate the mechanism called back gear.
Back gear mechanism. Okay.
So there is basically there is a pin. Mm-hmm. There is a pin. When you engage this pin, you know, this portion and this portion will get connected. So power will come from the integer motor through this
shaft actually.
You can get the
output. Okay, when the pin is engaged, the rotation moment will be transferred to the next piece of the spindle and this thing rotates.
Yes.
When you disengage
the pin, actually it is looking like different pieces, you know,
like automobile clutch working actually.
Yeah, actually this is automobile gear mechanism, I mean gearbox design.
You know, if it is disengaged, we will not get power to this
part.
It's like a neutral position.
Okay. Okay, so this is how we obtain different speeds for the chuck or workpiece in a lathe mechanism.
And we also see a back gear.
There is a back gear mechanism. In order to, you know, the back gear is a mechanism used for getting addition for low speed. Already say that for purposes like training, you need to have a low speed. At that time, you disengage this pin.
Okay.
You disconnect the two spindles.
Great.
Then you will connect. You connect the back gear engagement, back mm-hmm. gear mechanism to this gear by actuating this lever.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So now the power will pass from individual motor to stepcon.
Yeah.
Stepcon to output
to
spindle
the
through this back gear mechanism.
Back gear mechanism.
Depending upon the position of this belt, right, we can get additional four different
speeds. Okay.
In total, we have 8 speeds.
We have 8
speeds. Like. Okay.
We'll get 8 speeds.
8 speeds. So this is all about a headstock of a symbol.
And in the symbols form is construction detail. I care how it works. That's all.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Let's discuss about a headstock. You know, we already discussed about the major functional details of a headstock. So now we go into the tailstock. What exactly is, and what are the different functions of a tailstock? It's the structure details also. You know, the tailstock is something. It is a structural member, member or component of a ideal part of a lathe. I mean, the central lathe, and it is to provide additional support to a long workpieces.
Okay.
I mean, in mass production, your component size is not limited to this thing. You know, you may have long workpieces, so you have to mount the workpieces
in between
the chuck and tailstock. So you can adjust the tailstock depending upon the different leg. Actually, maximum length of a work that you can turn on a lathe is limited to the maximum distance between
the chuck
and
The tailstock. Okay.
Okay. You can mount the workpieces mm-hmm. like this thing, and the other functions of tailstock is that you know this portion is called lathe sender. I mean, this is a lathe sender.
Mm-hmm.
Lathe sender for basic purposes that to provide the additional support.
Mm-hmm.
You can easily replace the lathe sender with some sort of different tools like reamer.
Okay, you can do internal reaming, drilling operation also by replacing the sender.
You can fit different tools here.
You can perform any operation if you want. That is the purpose of the tailstock.
Tailstock, okay.
And what I'm saying that, you know, the function of the tailstock is not limited to the support.
Just holding the workpiece, more than that actually. You can do different operations like drilling, reaming and all those things.
All these things.
Okay, let's discuss about the sender.
So, I think this is a sender.
Mm-hmm.
This is anti friction roller sender.
Mm-hmm.
And this portion is actually called the sender.
Mm-hmm.
This is anti-frictional structural details.
Okay.
And some sort of a bearing mechanism provided here.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, this sender is rotating.
Okay. The only part component rotating in this, that only.
Okay. Understand. And this version is called tapered shank.
Shank. Okay.
Actually, the structure, I mean, all the component made from tough steel.
Mm-hmm.
And it is properly heat treated,
mm-hmm.
in order to give additional stiffness, embed strength, etc.
Okay, temperature resistance and all.
Okay.
It seems like it is something tapered and all.
Yeah, we provide some kind of a standard taper on this thing and this portion. You know, when you detail go into
mm-hmm.
the tail show structure, you can see that it is mounted upon the
prepared.
Bed. And it have a hollow structure.
Mm-hmm.
This is entirely a hollow structure. Instead of that hollow structure, we insert another hollow shaft. Hollow
okay.
shaft called barrel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you cut the barrel in a half-like manner,
mm-hmm.
you can easily see that this portion is actually hollow tapered thing.
Mm-hmm.
From this portion to this portion, it is entirely hollow thing.
Mm-hmm.
It is a uniform cross-section actually.
Cross-section, okay.
And this is a
solid part.
Oh, this is a solid part.
Okay.
And there is a screw just like lead screw provided here.
Okay.
Actually, it
mm-hmm.
rotate inside a screws mechanism. So
okay.
like a bolt, you can adjust the position.
Okay.
Of
yeah,
the barrel.
Okay.
I mean, you can convert the rotary motion into linear motion.
Linear motion. Great.
So in order to constrain this barrel,
mm-hmm.
you know, to linear motion to
mm-hmm.
prevent the rotations,
mm-hmm.
inverse rotations, there is a slot provided here. You can see.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
That slot is, you know,
preventing the rotation.
Yeah,
motion.
Preventing the rotation, and there is some sort of projections provided. In this hollow structure,
right?
So you can easily prevent the rotational motion.
If that means this barrel have only axial motion.
Yeah,
preventing the rotary motion.
Yeah, we yeah. don't want any rotary motion.
Can you show how to fix that spindle
yeah.
on that?
Yo.
Yeah, the sender.
Just like this thing, you
okay.
ram it actually into
that spindle position. Inside. Okay, hollow section.
Between spindle and barrel, only frictional forces.
Okay.
Okay.
So this conical shape is enhancing the friction.
Enhancing the friction. The basic idea behind, you know, providing the standard taper is that, you know, we provide this taper on this portion and inside this portion. This is something, you know, it is having same kind of taper.
Mm-hmm.
And that is called, the taper is called most taper, I think. There are so many different types of tappers, but in these cases of, you know, machine tools, we provide most taper. So after you insert in this sender into barrel,
mm-hmm.
you can easily adjust the position of
okay adjust
you,
the length
okay,
okay,
if
okay.
You want. And there is a locking mechanism provided here, so
okay.
you can easily lock at any position if you want. So
okay.
after you lock this thing,
mm-hmm.
you know, it do not perform any rotary motion
or any
rotary motion, and there is no axial motion.
Okay. Then there is another bolt.
Yeah. Actually, you know, you have to adjust the tail show,
mm-hmm.
depending upon the length.
Length
so,
you needed.
So there is a bolt provided here. The bolt actually when after lose this
mm-hmm.
bolt, you can adjust the position of tail show
along the belt actually. Okay. So
according to the length of the workpiece, we can adjust this.
And
by locking it, actually we are locking this part.
This part.
Okay.
And yeah.
This is an offset adjusting screw, I think. In some operation, just like, you know, you already okay,
mm-hmm.
just like taper turning.
Okay.
I mean, in cases of taper turning, you
mm-hmm.
can perform the taper turning
okay.
By tail stroke setover method.
Mm-hmm.
For that purposes, by rotating this screw,
mm-hmm.
you can adjust. You know, you can give some transverse offset to tail stroke.
Tail stroke. Okay, you can move from the center. Actually,
I think you can easily move from the center.
Center. Okay. Okay. For,
so. Mm-hmm. So when you perform the operation just like this thing, now the tail stroke move in this direction.
In this
so there exists some offset between
offset.
Axis.
Okay.
So what can rotate? Okay, along this axis.
This
inclined axis.
Inclined axis. Okay.
Okay. Then, what is the basic advantage with this thing is that, you know, you have to constrain the tool along
mm-hmm.
horizontal axis only,
mm-hmm.
but But work is inclined at some particular angle. I mean, okay. Half of the taper angle.
Mm-hmm.
By this way, you can easily get taper
turning and also. Okay.
So that is a.
This is another application in tailstock.
Okay.
So this is all about tailstock of a lathe. Thank you.
In this video, we are just going to discuss what is the difference between a single way tool post and four way tool post. I think. So before going to our topic, we just want to discuss from the base thing. I think. All the concepts of carries, and we go detailing about difference between the single way two post and the four way two post. You know, the carries, entire assembly called the carries, including the tail post, including the tool post also. So the entire carriage is used for the linear, I mean the tangential as well as the longitudinal and the transverse movement of the tool post, but the thing is that actually tool post is something, you know, is the kind of the device used for holding tool in a proper location firmly and to adjust the tool in a such a way that its tip and center of the shaft, center of the lathe can adjust easily. Can you
show that, like how to adjust center?
Let's assume that a tool. You just place this thing. Upon the, you know, this arrangement is called rock ramp. Can mm-hmm. it, because of the reason that it can be rock, it can rock.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you place a tool upon this rock ramp.
Rock ramp. Okay.
And you just adjust this tool tip
of the tool to the center.
Okay, center. Then you just
adjust the height of the height of the tool. So this is how. Okay.
Okay. This is actually a single way tool post. And you know, the thing is that you can only mount at a time. What I'm saying that at a time you can only mount one tool.
But
in mass production cases, you know, you just want to manufacture components involving, I mean, there are so many different operations you have to perform to get final part. For example, you need to perform first a turning, then
a forming
process. Mm-hmm. At that time, you have to change the tool.
Okay.
So you know, after changing, you have to release this tailstock and rearrange that thing.
You mean that it
consuming a lot of time.
Okay. You mean that when you want to perform a different operation like forming, you have to remove the tool and again you have to reset the tool. Okay. It will affect the production time of the thing. For solving that purpose, we are going to use four-way tool.
What I'm saying, you know, this is not a disadvantage. You know. The construction is good, different days, even though it primarily used for
simple type of
operations.
Lathe operations, like in a workshop and all.
So
okay.
I think it's the time to
move on to the four-way tool post. Okay, this is a typical type of four-way tool post.
Four-way tool post?
Yeah.
At the time, what I'm saying that you can mount different tools before performing the operation. Actually, you can mount the tool just like this thing.
Mm-hmm.
Suppose this is the first tool.
This
is the first tool. This is the second tool.
Second tool.
This is the third tool, and this is the fourth tool.
Okay, by adjusting these things, you can lock it.
You can initially lock this thing.
Okay.
If you want to perform operation like turning first,
mm-hmm.
then you perform the operation with
the first tool. Okay.
Mm-hmm. I think you perform the operation with the turning tool,
mm-hmm.
and you already seen that after the turning operation, if you need to perform operation like forming process, then you have to remove the tool from the.
Okay.
You have to readjust mm-hmm. every operation. You have to perform repeatedly. Okay. But in this situation, you just simply turn this entire structure.
Okay.
So this portion will be came into this position.
Okay. The different tool will be come in action.
You initially hold this. There is a forming tool.
Mm-hmm.
Depending upon the sequence of operation you're going to perform. So
okay.
this will finally reduces the production time. Mm-hmm. Once you reduce the production time, automatically what happens is that productivity of industry will improve.
That's the difference. Okay, this is the difference between a single way tool post and four way tool post. Thank you so much.